Good afternoon. Ooh, it's nice to see everyone. My name is Karina Rotenstein. I'm the programmer of the TIFF Industry Conference, and welcome to our final masterclass of 2018. But it's very exciting. Thank you. To begin, we'd like to acknowledge that every day we gather, live, and work on Indigenous land, and our events today are taking place on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of New Credit and on the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat. We are so grateful to work in the community. Just also a friendly reminder that there is no professional photography or video recording of today's session, but not to worry, we are taking care of it for you. We are live streaming, and we know that international audiences and fans of Jiang Wen's work are tuning in, so hello to our audiences online. And those of you who are online, please keep the conversation and using the hashtag TIFF18 so we can all stay connected and keep this rolling. So we could not be more thrilled to conclude our masterclass series with the one, the only, Jiang Wen. One of cinema's leading multifaceted artists and one of the most creative filmmakers around. You know him from his titles, Hibiscus Town, Red Sorghum, Black Snow, and In the Heat of the Sun, and of course, The Devil on the Doorstep, The Sun Also Rises, Let the Bullets Fly, and Gone with the Bullets. That's only just a fraction of his incredible body of work. And like his films, he has charted a long and exciting career filled with twists, turns, risk, and success. He has dealt with censorship at home while celebrated internationally, from art house cinema to blockbuster mogul, and pushing creative boundaries and exploring the depths of his ideas with innovation, conviction, and humor, and all made for the largest cinema-going audience in the world. Jiang Wen recently introduced himself to a whole new fan base as Baze Malbus in Rogue One, and that really signaled a shift in Hollywood, and especially in the Star Wars franchise, that Chinese talent could simply not be ignored. Now, at TIFF, we have always known that his incredible contribution to cinema has been undeniable, and we are so thrilled to welcome him here this year with the international premiere of Hidden Man, screening in our Gala Presentations, premiering on Friday, September the 14th at 9:30. Now, honestly, everybody in this room, please get ready. This is a spectacular event you will not want to miss. It's screening at Roy Thompson Hall. We have a brand new screen, so this Friday, 9:30 p.m., you all have plans. Get ready. It's gonna be electrifying. So we are so honored to welcome Jiang Wen to our stage today, and joining him is TIFF's artistic director and new co-head, Mr. Cameron Bailey. The two of them will be joined on stage by interpreter Alexandra Fung. Now, before we begin, let us take a look at what makes Jiang Wen such a captivating artist. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Mr. Cameron Bailey, Mr. Jiang Wen, and Ming Feng. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. And Director Zhang, welcome to Toronto.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please have a seat. It's a great pleasure to have you here and to be making the North American premiere of Hidden Man on Friday. The clip reel is just spectacular, and it really shows the energy, the style of your filmmaking. Your films are known for being very exciting, funny, and sometimes provocative. What effect do you want your films to have on audiences?
So I'm going to translate it to Mandarin as well, the question. 刚才呢放了一些这个片段，就是您的电影真是这个让人觉得效果非常好，视觉效果非常非常好。而且您的电影呢也是大家都了解，就是是有那种故事性特别强、进展特别快，而且又特别特别幽默感特别强的这么一些效果。那么您拍电影是希望达到的效果是什么样的呢？
<笑>我希望达到的就是这个效果。<笑>
That's the effect I like to achieve.
对，所以我觉得他的感受就是我想达到的效果，所以实现了我的效果。And
I'm glad that that's the feeling that you got from the movies, and that is what I'm trying to express.
I love the energy, but also the pace of your films. I'm going to ask you a simple, maybe a naive question. Why are your films so fast?
我可能刚才跟我太太来的路上还说，可能我是一个耐心比较差的人。
I was actually talking about it on the way here with my wife. I think maybe part of the reason is that I'm not a very patient person.
我也很奇怪，但是实际上看的时候还是有时候我看的时候，我不觉得快。第一次提醒我说节奏其实并不慢的，是在我想想啊，25年前，在东京现象所，我在那儿做，在日本做那个电影的叫什么来着？配光，他在一个镜头一个镜头配那个时候，没有电脑配光。然后他们就说，你这个电影又不是个武打片，又不是成龙的电影，又不是李小龙电影，但是你里边镜头数好像比香港电影还多。
I probably caught by surprise for a little bit at the beginning that people perceive it as being so fast-paced. And I was told of that the very first time about 25 years ago. I was in Tokyo, and what we were doing is to get the lighting effect for each shot. And the people there was talking to me and they said, wow, there's a lot of changes in scenes and a lot of differences. This is actually not an action movie. This is not a Jackie Chan movie or Bruce Lee movie. And yet there is a lot of going on. And that's what that first time I was told that it seems to be a very fast storytelling.
改了很多，改变其实剪接点，就是每个镜头的剪接点，就是说你有多少个镜头。就一般他们说动作片可能在2000个，其实我那已经超过2000个，甚至更多，是剪接点的意思。So
when we're talking about numbers, we're talking about the cuts of editing cuts. So for an action movie, they might have 2,000 of them on average, and mine was more than that.
但是也有他们产生错觉的地方，比如说，我可能有20个剪接点，但你看的时候不是一个这样马上过去的，它可能是一个流畅的过程。比如说 阳光灿烂里边那个马小军拿着那个望远镜这样看，插这样，他能看见那个蚊帐后边米兰的照片。实际上你要拿望远镜这么过就过去了，那我让这个照片在望远镜里边产生一个印象，所以必须让它过去之后吧再回来，过去又再回来，这里边得用不同的解决方式让这个照片能够在你的视觉里边保存，因为可能得在，因为一秒钟24格，你如果一格是没有印象的，你可能在4格才会产生印象，所以这里边是一个技术问题，就是我想让它产生一个印象，但实际上你做了很多剪接点，但实际上并不是一个仅仅快的一个效果。
So, part of that is technical. When I said I have a lot of editing points, is not that I have a shot from here, a shot from there. For example, in the movie, The Heat of the Sun, there's one shot which was, there's one scene that Ma Xiaojun was on the rooftop and he was looking from a telescope through, he was looking through the window.
Not on the rooftop, just in the room.
In the room, looking through her,
the picture.
From the mosquito net through a picture. of the female lead. And so in order to have that picture actually register an effect in the audience mind, I want the picture to be shown. And so that needs a different cut. So instead of his vision just going through the room, that picture has to become registered in one's mind. And 1 second could have 20 pixels, or 20. And so in order to have that registered, you need less, you need more than one, you need maybe 4. So that's why I wanted to have an extra cut to in order to have that effect. So even though there are more cuts, but it's still a very fluent, very continuous motion, except I just want to be able to have that kind of control of what the audience sees.
I see.
Anyway, you still feel that's quick. Mm-hmm. That's fast.
How much of the fast pace of your films happens in editing, and how much happens in the writing of the script?
快速节奏的这一部分，您觉得是在创作的时候就有这样的效果了，还是在剪接的时候，产生的这样的效果呢？
That's a good question.
我觉得写的时候并不慢。
Microphone.
因为我想说的挺多的，又只有2个小时，所以可能只能让它尽量节省点时间吧。但是剪的时候会不自觉地把一些废没用的东西拿掉，因为这可能我跟我的成长经历有关系。我大概23、24岁的时候去电影节，当时我记得去西班牙的电影节，我看所有电影都特别节奏特别好，特别快，都砸在心眼里，就尤其那时候年轻啊，喜欢一种快节奏，都扭脸在看当时去的中国电影，是觉得我操怎么这么慢啊？看半天还在这儿，我当时想，我说不行，我坚决不能再拍这种慢节奏的，我一定要有一天让一个外国人问我，姜文，你的电影为什么拍的节奏这么快？
Well, that's a very good question. I think when I'm writing, I'm definitely not writing slowly. There is a lot of things I want to say, and it's only 2 hours, so there's a lot of story to be told in that 2 hours. So when I'm writing, I'm definitely not slow. Then, during the editing, of course, a lot of extra got cut off, so that make it even faster. I remember when I was 23, I went to a film festival that was in Spain. I remember watching films there, and they seemed to be quite fast-paced then. And even though it's fast-paced, it did hit the audience heart at the right places. So that's in comparison to watch Chinese film at the time, I felt like, wow, this is kind of slow. So that's what I think part of the reason why I thought I want to make something that flows faster. And so maybe one day someone would ask me the question, why your films are so fast?
I want to go back to how you became a filmmaker, beginning in childhood. As a child, you watched films from China, of course, but also from the Soviet Union, given the time. When did you first become interested in movies, and was there one film or one experience of a film that did it for you?
想问问您，就是这个电影创作的这个经历啦。那您小的时候呢，是在中国的时候，是看中国电影，可能也会看一些这个苏联的电影。那么是什么使您产生对电影产生的兴趣啦？是不是有哪部片子，让您觉得哎想要做电影哈？有没有这样的经历呢？
对小孩来说吧，其实就是打仗的电影让我最觉得兴奋，因为我不知道那是假的，我以为是真的。然后当然有时候也会让我觉得很恐怖，然后就吓着我了。这个东西我就觉得啊，这是可以吓着人的，也可以让这些人这么多大人来一起玩打仗，那这个让我特别上瘾，想将来
Well, as a kid, I was interested in movies that portraying wars because I didn't know they were fake. I thought that was real. And I thought it was very exciting. And also, I get scared by some of it as well. So I felt, wow, this is something that could excite people, that could scare people. You can get so many adults together to do this thing that would have that effect. And so that was something I felt like that's something very cool and interesting.
Was there a particular war film that you remember?
I remember, but I'm afraid you might not.
Maybe not.
But I know we're almost same age, but that's Chinese film.
我觉得是什么呢？我不知道，我恐怕你也不知道。这电影叫《平原游击队》，谁知道啊？我知道，但我不知道有没有这个英文名字，我得自创一下。Mr. Jiang is asking me whether I remember this movie. I said I do, but I don't remember a English translation of the title. It's called I guess it's guerrilla warfare on the prairie, something like that.
That's right. 这电影呢？ 后来我发现还有个电影叫《南征北战》啊。
And then there's another one called, The War Towards the North and the South.
Okay.
它好，它有意思，都是50年代拍的。我记得两个电影好像都是52年拍的，都是在我出生以前的11年前。我就是这俩电影，我不知道为什么就是迷恋的老看老看，然后追着去各种电影院看。有一次。 发生这样的事儿，就是在70年代，那个电影里边的很多演员在文革当中就被打倒了，就进了牛棚，就没有工作机会了。然后文革的时候出了一个特别奇怪的事，他们把它重新拍一遍 ，remake， 然后就变成彩色的了。我去看平原队，平原军队，我一看啊，怎么这么难看，怎么那么多颜色，然后人也都不对了，装模作样的，然后我就特别悲愤的就故意让所有人看见我站起来走了。 然后去看那个电影也是，我一看，怎么又变成一个新电影了？我也是就走了，就很抗议的那样。 那从这两件事，我发现我很迷恋那两个电影。
So those two movies, I believe, were filmed in 1952. So that would be 11 years before I was born. So when I was a kid, I was following them. So I follow them to different cinemas. If they were shown in a particular cinema, I would go to that cinema to watch those two movies. And then something happened, something interesting happened, because during the Cultural Revolution, some of the cast members, they did a remake. They made it, instead of a black and white movie, they made it a colored version of it. And because some of the cast member were denounced, so they were not allowed to work.
Yeah, especially the hero man. They have to change different guy.
They changed the lead character because he had been denounced.
Yeah, they changed some handsome guy. or some guy looking like, you never know, he's yeah, very, very beautiful guy. Mm. But that's terrible.
So the effect became so different. And I was really, really surprised and shocked and thinking, how could they make such original vision to something like this? So I actually made a point of standing up in the middle of the cinema and left in the middle of the movie.
我后来我才明白，其实那个平原游击队其实很像一个西部片，就是英雄骑着马拿双枪。 一两个英雄可以从山上下来，把日本军队给搞乱，然后胜利了走了。我后来看了一个 Jiang Wen 的电影，有点像我的名字啊 ，Jiang Wen，almost like that。叫什么我忘了，就是他从赶着马，然后从这个马追到那边，从马追到那边，在那个马背上跳。总之吧，我觉得其实那个平原游击队很像一个美国的西部片。
So the guerrilla warfare on the prairie, that movie is actually, now looking at it, is quite similar to a Western movie. They had scenes of only maybe a couple of the heroes coming down from a hill, and they will be on horseback. They will be shooting from both hands, not holding the horse, and they would like run through a troop of Japanese soldiers, completely disturb them, and then go back. So that sort of scene can almost be a bit Western.
Sounds like John Wayne.
Yeah, and so John Wayne sounds like a very similar name to
John
mine.
Wayne, Jiang Wen. Yeah. I see, yes.
So I later on saw a movie of his, of Jiang Wen's movie, and I saw some scenes of him on the horse, and it is actually somewhat similar.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. I had never made that connection before.
The next time you come to Beijing, I'll show you that film.
Okay, I would love to see it. As you got a bit older, you went to the Central Academy of Drama in Beijing and graduated just as the directors who became known as fifth generation were graduating from the Beijing Film Academy, and you performed in Zhang Yimou's Red Sorghum. And I wonder how that generation, you, Zhang Yimou, Chen Kaige, and the other filmmakers who are known as the fifth generation, how did you all at that time change Chinese cinema?
您在中戏的时候呢，刚好呢，这个还有北影的一些导演也是跟他们差不多，都是一个时候在开始进入电影的。那么后来呢，您也参与了那个张艺谋的这个《红高粱》的拍摄。那您觉得，就是您们那一代的，就是他们叫这个第五代导演的这一代张艺谋啊、陈凯歌呀、这些导演，以及您，您觉得您们这一代人是怎么改变中国电影的呢？
Actually, we are same generation.
Yes.
I'm just 1 year older than you. I was born in 1963.
Actually, I was born in the same year, but a little later.
That guy was born before the guerrilla. I told us the film, right? That's totally different generation with me.
Okay.
我要说的是，其实我不知道在中国有没有第五代这件事儿。我一直是不认为可以用代来衡量创作者的，当然我也听说这是为了表述方便，但是对我来说一直很困难的接受这个说法。我认为是电影是由不同的人拍的，尽管他们是一代，恐怕也是不一样的做法。 这是第二呢，当然我觉得很多年轻的人拍出来的电影都有耳目一新的感觉，不断耳目一新，我先让你翻译吧。好。So
the term the fifth generation of directors, I'm not sure how often that's been used in the Chinese context. I think perhaps it's really a way, it's easier to use it to describe something sometimes. But I had a hard time taking it because the, like I said, some of them are a lot older than me. Mm-hmm. Some of them were born before those two movies I was talking about were made. And I think movies are individuals making movies, are each filmmakers making movies. So that's one point. And also another point is I think for younger filmmakers, often they have a very fresh take. And so you look at some younger filmmaker, you go, ah, that's a fresh approach. Oh, that's another fresh approach. That's another one.
但问题是，就像这个 Billy Wilder， 他会问一句话说：“那到底新在哪儿啊？”So
Billy Wilder would ask the question of what part of it is actually fresh. What's new about it?
对，其实他说的对。如果是那么新一下，那这世界得新成什么样啊？那早就变成了一个理想世界了。其实。
So, if they are actually completely new, you got something completely new, and then you got something else that's completely new again, and you got something else that's completely new. So then you would have had so many dramatic changes and progress. We would get to something else already. We'll be in utopia already. Mm-hmm.
我想说的是，其实这种新其实都是换了一件新衣服而已。然后，人不可能变得那么快。然后，你如果真的想把你的电影变得太新的话，就有很多的大部分的观众就跟你说我看不懂，我不知道你在拍的是什么，然后就跟不上了。电影其实没有办法做得太新。
But what I'm thinking is that what's new about these is perhaps a new wardrobe because the person inside is not completely new. One cannot make a completely different and completely new film because the audience would question that and say, well, I'm not really sure what that was all about. And they might not understand what you're trying to portray. So changes and things of that nature cannot perhaps be as new as the space of changes can perhaps might not be that new.
Okay.
可能法国人在二战以后做了一些，包括意大利人或者德国人。 新电影或者新浪潮，其实做到一定程度都会停在那儿，因为观众长起来之后，他们其实没比上一代新到哪儿去，或者说不是观众的事儿，就是人类 没有那么快的发展，那么快的进化。这就是为什么我们现在还能看八十年前的电影，还把它当成经典的原因。做太新了，它不是文学，文学有时候也会遇见这个问题啊。
After the Second World War, there were filmmakers from France, Italy, Germany. They were trying to make some really, really revolutionary new films, and they got new waves of those films made. And then after a certain point, it kind of paused at that point because the audience way of thinking is still their original way of thinking. So that's why sometimes even in literature as well, they have that issue, which is that literature and film would have to reflect the way the audience are thinking.
I see.
我觉得我可能比较幸运的是，我跟中国大概从100岁了，那个导演可能已经到100岁，和比我小10岁的每一个年龄段的导演差不多都合作过，这是比较幸运的。但是也让我从中观察到，其实大家都是在努力的讲啊，可以让大家理解的故事。当然会技术各方面会好一点，只是让他们唯一的进步是可以逐渐往个人化和心灵里边去，但是仍然很困难。
There's one thing I would catch up with the translation, which is what he said before, was that that's why people can still, audience could still enjoy the films that was taken 80 years ago, that still be viewed well and treated as a classic. So I'm very lucky because I've worked with directors and filmmakers and a lot of other people in the industry of different ages. I've worked with people who's now 100 years old. I've worked with people who are a lot younger than me. So I think what I got from it is that people are still trying to tell a story of their own. So perhaps now with new technology, there's technically there's not a lot of new approaches. But at the end, it's still filmmakers trying to tell a story. And perhaps now they can get more into their individual interpretation.
I see. In 1994, you made your first film as a writer and director. And I'm curious as to why you decided to not simply act anymore, but to also tell your own stories, to write and direct too.
1994年的时候呢，您就做了一部第一部您自己创作跟导演的电影。那么就想问问您，当时为什么有这个想法呢？觉得不单单是演戏了，而且要自己做一个电影了呢？
我做演员的时候，经常帮导演写剧本。
I was helping out the directors with the scripts.When I was an actor,
我参加的很多电影里边都有我写的部分。
And a lot of the films that I've acted had parts of it that was written by me.
然后那些导演有时候会很高兴，有时候也会假装高兴，心里不高兴。然后说那算了，你干脆你自己当导演得了。
And sometimes directors would be very, very happy with that. And other times they perhaps seems to be happy, but not quite happy inside. And then there will be sort of feelings of, well, maybe you should do something on your own, and maybe you should write one and direct one. And
那不管怎么说，后来我说那好吧，既然我愿意写剧本，那就自己导呗。
And so that's how I thought. Well, since I like writing scripts,
还有一个关键的问题就是我看了很多关于文革的电影。那个时候，我觉得不是我想象的那样。我觉得他们太像一个结论，一个报纸的结论。我 其实在我看的那个我感受到的那部分我愿意把它表现出来，所以我拍了《阳光灿烂的日子》，正好有王朔的小说给我，我觉得这个更接近真实的样子。
And also during that time, I did see a lot of movie that's talking about the Cultural Revolution or touched the Cultural Revolution, and I felt that was not the feeling that I had towards it, or not some of the things I've experienced during the Cultural Revolution. So that's why it also happened that Wang Shuo had the novel, and it could be worked as a framework, and that's why I wanted to portray it not so much as a newspaper conclusion of the Cultural Revolution, but rather something that's similar to my experiences during that.
Your films have been hugely popular in China. The most recent trilogy of films, Gone with the Bullets, Let the Bullets Fly, and now Hidden Man especially. But popular films in China sometimes have a hard time being as popular outside of China, in the West especially. There's an audience that follows your work quite closely in North America, but I think we're still waiting for the Chinese blockbuster that will also be a blockbuster in North America. What do you think it will take?
您的这个电影在中国是非常非常受欢迎的，尤其是这个几部，这个《让子弹飞》、《一步之遥》，还有现在这个《邪不压正》，都是在中国是非常非常受欢迎的。那么，在北美，也有很多人确实是关注您的电影的，中国电影就是在中国特别特别受欢迎的电影呢，好像在国外这个能以同样程度受欢迎的呢，好像还不容易做到。那您觉得是需要什么样的这个元素才能够在中国也非常非常受欢迎，同时在国外在北美也能达到像在中国那样受欢迎的程度呢？
他真是很爱中国的一个人呢，谢谢你。
You sounds like someone who really loves China.
I do.
Thank you for that question.
这对中国电影提多么高的要求啊！
That's a lot to ask for a Chinese movie.
我回答这个问题之前，我想问，有哪个国家可以达到这样的情况呢？在自己国家也卖得非常好，全世界也非常好，哪个国家可以这样？
I'm thinking about it. Which country quite often produce films that are wildly accepted in their own country and also accepted wildly well in the internationally? I'm trying to think which countries usually have films of that sort.
我觉得连圣经都达不到。
The Bible probably wouldn't be able to do that.
You're right, it's very rare. The occasional British film like The King's Speech or a French film like The Untouchables becomes popular around the world, but it's not very common, you're right.
您说的对，这确实是很少见的现象，可能偶尔有一些英国电影啊，比如说那个有一个叫 The King's Speech, 那国王的演说，还有一个，比如说有个法国电影叫 The Untouchables, 那个可能有那么个别的能有这样的。
是，奇迹总会发生的，意外也会发生的。
Miracle happens, of course.
就像我那个《子弹飞》在中国卖那么好的票房，其实也是个意外。我也不知道为什么，我超出我的想象。
And as a matter of fact, Let the Bullets Fly did so well in the Chinese market. That's actually a surprise to me. I didn't know it would do that well.
可能更接近平原游击队了吧。
Maybe because it is a little bit closer to the movie that I was just talking about, the gorillas on the prairie.
但我非常同意他说，我也其实特别盼望着有一种电影是全世界都能同时看、同时喜欢的，但确实挺少的。我也看过一些好的法国电影。 德国电影，包括南美的电影。我说怎么谁都不知道啊？他们也没看过，好多人没看过，很奇怪。但是以前美国电影在中国还是美国喜欢的，中国就能喜欢。但是现在美国好多电影在中国也不行了，有些到中国也大家也觉得，我觉得这也许不是一件坏事，就是每个人有每个人强烈的自我要求吧，自我需求是吧？
The question that you were asking, I think that's a very important question, is that what kind of film could be doing well in one cultural market and then still also doing very well internationally. I've seen a lot of foreign films. I've saw a lot of French films, German films, and also South American films. And some of the films that I've seen, I think, were really, really good films, and yet I'm surprised that not a lot of people had known about them. So it is a question of what people find accessible. And also, I mean, it perhaps used to be the case that American films that have done well in the US market would also do well internationally, also would do well in the Chinese market. But that seems to be changing slowly, that the films that are doing well in the US are not necessarily doing well in China anymore. And I think that also reflects on perhaps more individualized taste.
你比如说星战，我参演的那个好像在北美就卖得特别好，在中国好像就是个中流的一个收入。
For example, one of the movies that I participated, one of the projects I did, which is the Star Wars film, which did very well in the U.S. And in China, it seems to be sort of in the mid-range in terms of effects.
你说你要没我在里边得什么样？
And you can think if you it only did medium well, what would happen without me?
I hear your son was a fan of the Star Wars films, and I imagine that when he saw Rogue One, a Star Wars story, he must have been very happy.
Is he? I don't know what to say. They are really very disappointed. 然后从小就看那个，我其实没看过啊，我一般看什么呢？他们跟我讲的特别多，特别生动。然后剧本也是给他们看，我大儿子说你必须演这个电影，这电影怎么怎么好。我说那我去，一定去。尽管我没看过前面，我也得努力的把它演好。然后就他们制片公司也挺好的，拿去给我看，招待我的家人。我就把俩儿子请去看了，看完之后。俩人就出去了。我说怎么样啊？行吧，就是，但是没有我看的那个头两个好。完了，我说那白去了。
Yeah, they are big fans. They're really really into all things Star Wars, and they were the ones who saw the series, and they were really really into it, both of them. And so I was approached, they said, oh, well, you have to do it. And then I showed them the script and they said, you know, you have to do it. So they were really, really excited about it. And so I said, okay, well then I guess I have to do it. And so, and then the production company was very, very nice. They invited all of my family to show them the product. And then afterwards I asked them, oh, what do you think? And the two of them kind of went, yeah, it was all right. And they seemed to think, you know, the original films was better. So
that's harder.
Yeah,
it's harder.
Always hard
harder
for
too young audience, uh-huh, right?
Right. In terms of making your films in China, censorship is a big part of the reality for filmmakers all over the world. Many, many different countries have to deal with this, including China. And I'm wondering, as you're writing and directing and editing your films, how do you navigate the realities of censorship?
电影是需要审查的，这个事情呢，在全世界好多地方都有，都有这种不同形式的这个元素和环节，那么就觉得您在创作的时候，在写作的时候，觉得是怎么样应对这个有审查这个环节的呢？
这个我也是很吃惊的是，我这两天正在看一本书，叫《Conversation with Billy Wilder》，这是美国一个很著 I guess you know this director, right?、Mm-hmm. 这书非常有意思，他在里边也在说，我很吃惊，那好莱坞的很成功的一个导演，就是《玛丽莲梦露》的，还有什么Herb 的那些片子，好多都是这个人拍的。这个人是一德国人，后来40-50年代、50-60年代在好莱坞拍了很多好片子。他也很痛苦，当时居然在好莱坞还有人审他的片子，还得改这儿改那儿的。我也很吃惊，我说这是什么情况？我不看他的东西，我也不知道。所以，我当然不希望有人审电影了，全世界没有人愿意喜欢这，但是现实在那儿摆着。他能告诉我怎么办吗？我 Billy Wilder 当时也没办法，他就等那事儿过去吧。我对我来说一个最好的办法就是我假装没有人审我，我写剧本的时候假装我想我怎么写就能怎么拍就完了。那你不能写剧本的时候老想这，你怎么写啊？
I'm reading a book called Conversation with Billy Wilder, and in the book, he talks about, I mean, he's a German filmmaker who worked in Hollywood in the 40s and 50s, and he worked with people like Marilyn Monroe, with Hepburn, and I was surprised at how much of a censorship and was required of the movies at that time, and that they were told, oh, you have to remake this part, you have to cut as such, and so on. So I think for any filmmaker, no one wants that to happen, that they have to have that kind of changes made to their films. But what I can only do when I'm writing is to pretend that's not going to happen. I would write my own story. Because if you think about that, you don't, how could you write? You can't.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The film you're here to present on Friday is Hidden Man. We have a trailer that I'd like to show from it, which shows, again, some of that really dazzling energy in the film for people who haven't seen this yet. And then I want to talk a little bit about Hidden Man. Let's look at that trailer.
Wow, amazing. Who's that director? trailer， 我后来才发现这是单声道的，原来都是好多声，弄得我都晕头转向的。这就一个声，其实可能更好点哈。
I wanted to say that oh, how fresh is this trailer? And something I realized is perhaps because the sound effect is not a stereo sound; it's only coming from one source, and that actually made it somewhat different, and it perhaps has a better effect.
Okay, that's good to know. because we're running short on time. I think I want to go straight to you so that we have some questions from you as well. So if you've got a question, we have, I think, microphones. Please put up your hand, and we'll get a microphone to you. Yes, right here. We'll start here.
我就想问您，您对这一代的导演有什么忠告吗？
对哪一代啊？
我们这一代就是比如像00年以后的。
你们是一代人啊，底下。 都一样，一波人。
对，就是差不多就像怎么说，年轻的还没有上，比如像。00，你是就在读书的学生是不是？对，读书的学生。对。你是读电影学院的是吗？
没有，我现在还在高中，我希望能进电影学院。我能对一个高中生。<laughs>
translation?
I'll translate that question for the non-speaking audience. Is there any advice you can give to this generation of directors? So Mr. Jiang asked, what do you mean by this generation? And so people who are born millennials who born in this century and who are perhaps still in high school hoping to get into film school.
我有一个，我要回答他问题吗？我就是我说我有一个另外一个 surprise. 刚才开灯之前我看底下黑压压一片啊，这么多观众。开个灯之后我一看好多是空座。
有点像我的电影，最后这电影在中国的上座率。There is something I just want to mention, because when we first came in, the light was dimmed, and I thought, oh, this is a big theater, and now I get to see there are so many empty seats. Probably a little bit like the screening that we had in China.
真的把灯关了吗？
Let's turn the lights off, please. Is that possible?
Go back to my dream. Thank you so much. All right. 我觉得给你的忠告就是你想干嘛干嘛，你现在才中学哈，千万别约束自己，你就相信你能拍的最好就完了。他们全不行，俱往矣，你就能拍好一电影。
Go back to his question of what advice I can give for people of your generation. I think the only thing I could say is do what you want to do. Don't limit yourself at this age. You're still in high school. Don't limit yourself and do what you truly believe in that you should do and say, well, I'm going to be the best. I am the best. And what happened, what's done is done, and do your own thing.
Thank you. We're going to try and get in a couple of more questions. Yes, right here.
Hello. Welcome to Toronto. You have been to many film festivals before, so how do you find TIFF?
Lovely.
您以前去过很多个电影节，然后您会想 问一下您觉得多伦多国际电影节对您的印象怎么样？谢谢。
就说 lovely. Very lovely place and very lovely film festival.
Thank
because
you.
Okay. Because this is a very relaxing.
Good. Over here.
江导您好，我是 from Ultra Media. 是这样子的，当时您在《让子弹飞》在中国上映的时候，我很有幸作为记者采访了您。然后我知道那部电影在中国是有多么多么的空前盛世。 甚至前无古人后无来者，因为您刚才说的是我的电影吗？真的呀，刚刚您说到《平原游击队》的时候，我知道那是郭振清老师的一个电影。您刚刚提到了两个的这个 connect， 就是可能带着那个 mask 从山上冲下来的时候，真的有那个时候的影子。 我可能觉得您是有那样的一个情节的。那我其实有个问题，就是说，一般导演都会讲情节、情怀。那么，我看到中国的报道，咱们这个电影在中国上映的时候，大片的报道是说您对女性有一定的情怀，就是您喜欢着重描写女性，甚至尊重女性。但是 I'm not sure 这是不是真的您的电影想表达的情怀？我特别想知道您的电影里真正想表达的情怀是什么？谢谢。
Okay, so I'll translate that question first. Lady here happened to be the from the media outlet that went to interview Mr. Jiang back in the days when Let the Bullets Fly first came out. And she was able to witness firsthand how that the level of well-respectedness of the film in China at the time. It seems to be no film before that and no film after had got such huge reception. So, and back to this film, there seems to be, well, a lot of directors and filmmakers seem to have an attachment of some sort towards a particular subject matter or of an atmosphere, and there's been said comments about this film, and that Mr. Jiang has feelings towards how to portray a female role, that he has particular respects for his female roles. So is that true? Is that one of his attachments? What is as a filmmaker, what is his feelings towards subject matters? What are the ones that he has feelings for?
你不用怀疑我对女性的崇拜。你看我的样子，让你怀疑这件事吗？
There's no doubt that I worship women. You don't have to question that. I mean, just look at me, and there's no question about that.
你可以认为那就是一个向女性致敬的电影。
You can see this film as I guess a tribute to women.
当然，里边男的也值得致敬。
But also, it's a tribute to men as well.
Okay.We're going to have to move on.
你不能说媒体有什么错误，这你要小心，尤其你是记者，别给我下套，你们都没错。
Okay, right here, yes, you. That'll be the. Sorry, there's someone behind you. We'll go to first. All right, we're almost out of time. Please go ahead. Maybe we can ask both questions and have both answered. Go ahead.
你好，姜文导演，我非常喜欢您的电影。那个我有这里有两个问题我想问一下，就是我呢非常想成为一名电影导演，但是我学的专业呢就是离这个有点远，我是学政治跟哲学的，就是说您是否推荐我去就是说去读一下电影学院那个比较正式的一个就是教育。还有就是我想问一下，你如何就是说，您在创作的时候，怎么样去平衡你自己的那种创作的欲望跟那种观众的接受程度？因为我自己之前导了一部电影，放了电影节放了之后，很多人看不懂，然后我就很困惑，就是，对，我还有一个问题，
你算找对人了，
谢谢，
因为我的电影也被好多人说看不懂。你看咱俩还怎么交流啊？交流都完，最后还是看不懂。
您就是我非常喜欢您的一部电影，叫做《太阳照常升起》，就是你们的那个镜头跟配乐都是真是so perfect， 就是太完美了。
那个电影在中国就是第一次被观众还有好多影评人，很猛烈的攻击我，就是看不懂，
对，
看不懂，所以。看不懂在中国是一个对导演不好的一件事儿。他们说你让我看不懂了，你就很失败。所以你问我，我会给你带到更深的沟里去。
您请讲，如果说愿意的话。
Can you translate, please?
Let me catch up first. So this gentleman had asked that he would like to be a filmmaker, and he is currently studying something that's quite different from filmmaking, which is politics and philosophy. So he would like to know whether Mr. Jiang's advice is whether he should go actually do a program in film studies or filmmaking. And also, a second part of his question is that he had made a film, but how to balance your desire as a filmmaker, as a writer, towards what your expectation of what the audience would like to see. And he did a film before, and he felt that it wasn't expressed well, and people didn't feel connected to what he was doing. And what he loved most about Mr. Jiang's work was The Sun Also Rise. And that he felt was the music was perfect, the lighting was perfect, and the whole cinematography was perfect. And Mr. Jiang was commenting on that was the film that was got the most critique in China, that people felt that they didn't understand what I was trying to do. So if you're asking me, how do I balance the question of making the audience know what you're trying to do, I perhaps would take you to the opposite direction.
But I can tell you something. 就是说，如果让人看得懂和让人看不懂两个都作为一种追求的话，让人看得懂是更容易的。
So what I like to tell you is that if you're looking at I want people to understand what I'm doing, or I don't want people to understand what I'm doing, if you look at those as goals, then it's easier.What the goal that's easier to achieve is to make people know what you're doing.
对一个创作者来说，与众不同的一个头脑很重要，与众不同的一个感受力很重要。你已经有了，所以呢，你就是想办法怎么跟大伙儿一样一点。这件事没那么难，长成你这样比较难。
As a creator.It's difficult to create something that is different. And so it's somewhat easier to be able to create something that people could identify with. So, I mean, so you've already had the more difficult part done, and now you're just trying to find some common grounds.
Thank you. All right, last question right here.
Hello, you mentioned that to make your movies feel more fast-paced, you involve a lot of cutting. How do you cut so much without making the audience lose focus?
您说了这个，之所以这个电影这么快，有其中一部分的效果呢，是剪接的时候产生的，剪了很多东西下去。那您怎么能够剪掉很多东西，但同时呢，仍然让观众能够保持他的注意度。
剪掉那些就是让观众保持注意度。
You want to keep the audience's focus by cutting a lot off.
你如果不剪的话，可能注意力就分散了。
It's that if you don't cut off those things, maybe then their minds start to wander.
Okay.We're going to have to leave it there, unfortunately, so I'll just ask you to please join me in thanking Director Jiang Wen. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.